And we welcome you to the Cathedral Church of All Saints here in Halifax, Nova Scotia. On this Sunday, we mark Remembrance Sunday, and our service and reflections will be on that theme. For those joining us online, do go to the Cathedral's homepage, and you can see the text, the bulletin for today, on the homepage. Just scroll down until you find it there, then join along with us. Our service today begins by acknowledging the lands where we gather. We acknowledge that we are in Mi'kmaq, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. This territory is covered by the treaties of peace and friendship, which Mi'kmaq and Wolastoyiag people first signed with the British Crown in 1725. The treaties did not deal with surrender of lands and resources, but in fact recognized Mi'kmaq and Wolastoyiag title and established the rules for what was to be an ongoing relationship between nations. We begin our worship with a choral introit, "The Lord is my light and my salvation."
Our service continues on page 185, or in your bulletins. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray the collect of the day together. Eternal God, in whose perfect realm no sword is drawn, the sword of justice, and no strength known but the strength of love, guide and inspire all who seek your kingdom, that peoples and nations may find their security in the love which casts out fear, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be a disaster, and their going from us to be their destruction. But they are at peace. For though in the sight of others they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive a great good, because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Like gold in the furnace, he tried them, and like a sacrificial burnt offering, he accepted them. In the time of their visitation, they will shine forth and will run like sparks through the stubble. They will govern nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord will reign over them forever. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his holy ones, and he watches over his elect. The word of the Lord. Let us say Psalm 116 responsively. I love the Lord because he had heard the voice of my supplication. because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I call upon him. The cords of death entangled me. The grips of the grave took hold of me.
I came to grief and sorrow.
Then I called upon the name of the Lord.
Lord, I pray you to save my life.
Gracious is the Lord and righteous.
Our God is full of compassion.
The Lord watches over the innocent.
I was brought very low and helped me.
Turn again to your rest, O my soul.
For the Lord has treated you well.
For you have rescued my life from death.
My eyes from tears and my feet from stumbling.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord.
In the land of the living.
Be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus said, "Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Like many of you I know, I woke up several times during the night on Tuesday and into the early hours of Wednesday to learn with both disbelief and a good deal of inner turmoil and dread that Donald Trump was not only well on his way to victory in the US presidential election, but in the end garnering a decisive majority. Some of you who follow politics across the border will know that the Republican Party, the grand old party, or GOP, who Trump represents, is symbolized by an elephant, a designation first attributed to the political cartoonist Thomas Nast of Harper's Weekly in the 1800s. But before I address any further the elephant that is now in the world's living room, let me share a slogan on this Remembrance Day from, of all places, a license plate. As many of you have come to know, I was born and raised in New Hampshire in the United States. I came to Canada to study at Huron College, the University of Western Ontario, in 1978. I met a student there. We got married, and I have lived here ever since. I became officially a landed immigrant in Canada on the 8th of August in 1981. Then last year, after 42 years, on November the 30th at 9 a.m., I became a Canadian citizen. So I now have the status of a dual citizen, and I can now, for the first time, vote in Canadian elections as well as U.S. elections. And I consider that a great honor and a privilege. But back to the license plate. Since 1971, the license plate for my home state of New Hampshire has as its motto the words, "Live free or die." Prior to that, it had one single word on the top of the plate that said, "Scenic." Not quite as attention-grabbing, admittedly, as live free or die, and I have over the years been questioned many times about that motto. For many, it paints a rather defiant, hostile, love it or leave it, gun-toting image of those that must live there. That's not been my experience, and I will add that New Hampshire voted blue on Tuesday. But in truth, I believe the motto captures the essence of this day of remembrance. The context of that motto comes from a letter written by General John Stark on July the 31st, 1809. Stark was a New Hampshire-born war hero, having served first as an officer in the British Army during the French and Indian War, and then as a major general for the Continental Army during the American Revolution, fighting against the British. Stark led troops at the Battle of Bunker Hill and later at the Battle of Bennington. Years later, recalling times when he and his troops were vastly outnumbered and victory seemed doubtful against a superior foe, he noted that, quote, "Death is not the greatest of evils. When given the choice, I would rather live free or die." Tomorrow, on the 11th day of the 11th month at 11 a.m., we will pause to mark the signing of the armistice that brought an end to the fighting of the First World War in 1918. Little did they know then that the cause of freedom, the cost of freedom, would not end there, but be an ongoing struggle even to this very day, that countless lives would be lost in the pursuit of peace and freedom. We remember the nearly 67,000 Canadian casualties of World War I, the 45,000 who died in the Second World War, 516 who lost their lives in the Korean conflict, 125 who fought and died in Vietnam, and more than 30,000 who served in the missions to Afghanistan, and the 159 who died there. And that's not to speak of the thousands who, while returning home, continue with their families to deal with wounds unseen that never heal. We also remember those currently active in the Canadian Armed Forces who continue to serve, some 68,000. Veterans Affairs Canada hosts a wonderful website of creative resources, history, and photo images devoted to this Remembrance Week. And it asks at the top of the page, why do we remember? To which is given this response, quote, we must remember. If we do not, the sacrifices of those 100,000 Canadian lives will be meaningless. They died for us, for their homes and families and friends, for a collection of traditions they cherished and a future they believed in. They died for Canada. And the meaning of their sacrifice rests with our collective national conscience. Our future is their monument. Those ideals, as expressed in the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, guarantees, among other things, the rights of freedom of conscience and religion, freedom of thought, belief, and expression, including freedom of the press and other media of communication, freedom of peaceable assembly, and freedom of association. That is why we remember. Our future is their monument. The outcome of the U.S. election is troubling for many, for it begs the question of what indeed we remember of past history, and what is the cost of freedom? In the words of Canadian John McCrae's poem, to you from failing hands we throw the torch, be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields. In 1948, in a speech to the British House of Commons, Winston Churchill said, those that fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it. A vast majority of the electorate in the United States, more than half, voted for a very different form of leader. A leader who, by the way, was very transparent about his motives, morals, and methods, and in doing so, opted for a very different direction for their future. That is both the strength and the peril of a true democracy, to allow us, the people, to make choices and ultimately to respect the choices of others, even when to many those choices seem untenable. I came upon an old Turkish proverb which reads like this. The forest was shrinking, but the trees kept voting for the axe, for the axe was clever and convinced the trees that because his handle was made of wood, he was one of them. Kamala Harris, in her gracious and inspiring concession speech, noted, a fundamental principle of American democracy is that when we lose an election, we accept the results. That principle, as much as any other, distinguishes a democracy from monarchy or tyranny. And anyone who seeks the public trust must honor it. At the same time, in our nation, we owe loyalty not to a president or to a party, but to the Constitution of the United States and loyalty to our conscience and to our God. My allegiance, she says, to all these three is why I am here to say that while I concede the election, I do not concede the fight that fueled this campaign. The fight for freedom, for opportunity, for fairness, and the dignity of all people. A fight for the ideals at the heart of our nation, the ideals that reflect America at our best. And that is a fight I will never give up. Only time will reveal the ripple effects of this election for the citizens of the United States and for the global community. What can our response be? One thing is to be prayerful, to pray without ceasing, as Paul writes to the Thessalonians, and believe that that is no small thing. We can be witnesses of hope and resurrection. We can speak to the power of love over the love of power. That's what we can do. As one religious commentator noted, Christianity has never been, in its essence, a faith of the majority, because the demands are high to love one another, to seek to lift up those marginalized, or to give voice to the voiceless, to sacrifice and not take, to lay down one's life for a friend, to see all of humanity as neighbor, to take up a cross. Remember, in their day, when given the choice, they voted for Barabbas over Jesus. And yet we are here, in this place, this morning. We are here, and the light shines on in the darkness. I personally find hope in many places, poetry being one of them. And someone asked me this week for a poem, like a prescription to ease their unease. You know, take two poems and call me in the morning. And there are many poems I can point to. But this week, my mind kept returning to the memory of a passage from Tolkien's Lord of the Rings trilogy, from the movie script, where Frodo, who has made it his life's quest to destroy a ring that holds unspeakable power for evil, a quest that has nearly destroyed him, he comes to the breaking point where to continue on seems more than pointless, when the darkness seems almost suffocating. But he is encouraged by his lifelong friend and companion, Samwise Gamgee. And Frodo falls to the ground and he moans, "I can't do this anymore." And Sam responds, "I know, it's all wrong. By rights, we shouldn't even be here, but we are. It's like in the great stories, Mr. Frodo, the ones that really mattered. Full of darkness and danger they were, and sometimes you didn't want to know the end. Because how could the end be happy? How could the world go back to the way it was when so much bad has happened? But in the end, it's only a passing thing, this shadow, for even darkness must pass. A new day will come, and when the sun shines, it will shine out the clearer. For those are the stories that stayed with you, that meant something, even if you were too small to understand why. But I think, Mr. Frodo, I do understand. I know now. Folk in those stories had lots of chances of turning back, only they didn't. They kept going because they were holding on to something." And Frodo asks him, "What are we holding on to, Sam?" "That there's some good in this world, Mr. Frodo. and it's worth fighting for. It's worth fighting for. To you from failing hands, we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high, lest we forget, lest we forget. Let us pray. God of love and liberty, we bring our thanks today for the peace and security we enjoy. We remember those who in times of war faithfully serve their country. We pray for their families and for ourselves whose freedom was won at such a cost. Make us a people zealous for peace, and hasten that day when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither learn war anymore. For this we pray in the name of the one who gave his life for the sake of this world, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our faith as we say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord, responding to "Hear our prayer" with "Have mercy, Lord." Hear our prayer.
Have mercy.
Almighty and everlasting God, we humbly ask you to receive our prayers of those who are here before you and those who are absent. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to the Church, to all bishops, priests, deacons, laity, and their congregation, especially for Anne, our acting primate, Sandra, our bishop, our wardens, Jackie and Zachary, and Mayanne, our warden emerita, for Paul, our rector and dean, for the clergy of the cathedral, active and retired, deacons Ray and Maggie, Blaine and Will, our theological interns, Paul, Nick, Russ, Pauline, and all who make music in this place, and all who minister here in so many ways, both lay and ordained. May they serve with faith, truth of doctrine, and rightly administer your holy sacraments. Hear our prayer.
Have mercy.
In our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of South India united. In our diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican chaplains of the Canadian Armed Forces in the Diocese of Nova Scotia and Prince Edward Island. Let us spread the gospel of Christ and message of love. Inspire us to serve the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the world, that as stewards of it, we will cherish it and protect it for today and tomorrow. Send your compassion and tolerance to those who lack it. Let every person of this planet welcome each other, despite our differences. We ask you to lead all nations and communities in the way of righteousness, and to guide their leaders with humility of heart, that the people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Grant to your servant Charles, our King, and all who are put in authority by him, that they may truly and impartially administer justice and good government. Protect all who serve in our armed forces at home and abroad from every peril of sea, land, and air. Defend them from all danger and grant them loyalty and courage to do what is just and right. Have mercy on those who are affected by the misery and horrors of war and conflict, and we pray that there may be an end to such strife. We especially pray for the conflicts in Gaza, Israel, Lebanon, Ukraine, Russia, and other areas of conflict. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for our community, we pray for our friends and neighbors, we pray for the faithful and those lacking in faith. We pray for those whom we've hurt or offended, we pray for students and those studying and working for a better world. And we pray for those who provide us with the things that give us comfort and sustainment of life, and we remember those who are not so fortunate to have such comforts. We pray for the homeless, the lost, the cold, the hungry, the forgotten, and those who have no one to pray for them. Lord, hear our prayer. We humbly pray to you, O Lord, to comfort and support all those in this world who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, pain, or any adversity, especially for whom our prayers are desired, remembering Emma, Gary, Lisa Jane, Philip, Dan, Stuti, Samuel, Timothy, Jonathan, Richard, Leslie, Leanne, Barbara, John, Joseph, Lucy, Linda, Shirley and family, Sylvia, Amber, Isabel, Francis and family, John, Elizabeth, Kevin, Michael, Bernie, Kenneth, Beasley, Eloise, Paulette, Regine, Bob, Linda, George, Marilyn, and Joyce. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray and remember, O Lord, all those who have departed this life and their loved ones, remembering Nicola and Richard. We also remember all those who have died in the past wars and conflicts, both in uniform and not, giving their lives as ultimate sacrifice that we may enjoy peace and comfort. Rest eternal grant them, O Lord, and may light perpetual shine upon them. Lord, hear our prayer. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. God welcomes sinners and invites them to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, in the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now let us exchange a sign of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Offertory hymn is 567, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. Let us pray the prayer over the gifts. Gracious and righteous Lord, we are united in the love of Jesus Christ. Accept all we offer you this day, and bring us with all your faithful people who have gone before us and to his eternal glory, who is Lord now and forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Eternal God, source of all being, we give you thanks and praise for your faithful love. You call us into friendship with you and one another, to be your holy people, a sign of your presence in the world. When those we trust betray us, unfailingly you remain with us. When we injure others, you confront us in your love and call us to the paths of righteousness. You stand with the weak and those broken and alone, whom you have always welcomed home, making the first last and the last first. Therefore, we raise our voices with angels and archangels, forever praising you and saying, Blessed are you, O Holy One. When Hagar was driven into the wilderness, you followed her and gave her hope. When Joseph was sold into bondage, you turned malice to your people's good. When you called Israel out of slavery, you brought them through the wilderness into the promised land. When your people were taken into exile, you wept with them by the river of Babylon and carried them home. At the right time, you sent your anointed one to stand with the poor, the outcast, and the oppressed. Jesus touched lepers and the sick and healed them. He accepted water from a woman of Samaria and offered her the water of new life. Jesus knew the desolation of the cross into the redemption of your reconciling. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus at supper with his friends took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread, gave it to them and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Loving and Holy One, recalling Christ's death and resurrection, we offer you these gifts, longing for the bread of tomorrow and the wine of the age to come. Therefore, we proclaim our hope.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in your glory.
Pour out your Spirit on these gifts. Through them, you may sustain us in our hunger for your peace. We hold before you all whose lives are marked by suffering, our sisters and brothers, when we are broken and cast aside, embrace us in your love. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, O source of life, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Look at the body of Christ is broken for the life of the world.
Here is Christ coming to us in bread and water.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of peace, whose Son, Jesus Christ, proclaimed the kingdom and restored the broken to wholeness of life, look with compassion on the anguish of the world, and by your healing power, make whole both people and nations. Through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. And now I would like to ask you to participate in the act of remembrance, beginning with our national anthem.
Thank you.
they shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
And now I would like to invite the presentation of the wreaths, and if you wish, you are welcome to leave your poppy at the altar. We will first have the cathedral wreath. Let us pray. O God, we honor today those men and women, our sons and daughters, husbands and wives, fathers, brothers, sisters, mothers, who laid down their lives for their country. Bless them forever in your eternal peace. Loving Lord, let the sounds of strife, the cries of battle, the wounds of war be calmed for all eternity in your loving and endless grace. Let these great warriors find rest at last, and ever reminded that we who are left behind cherish their spirit, honor their commitment, and send them our love and vow never to forget the service that they gave. Go forth now to care for God's world. Live in harmony with all creation. Go out into all the world as prophets of a new way of living, and preach the good news to all. And the blessing of the Creator God, the risen Son, and the promised Holy Spirit bless you, that you might be a blessing to others, today and always. Amen. And our